someone shout hallelujah. Someone shout hallelujah.
Thank you. your seat briefly. We thank God for each and every one of you for turning up this morning for this special service, joint service. I pray that as you came, you will have something to show for it in the name of Jesus. Very soon, we are going to be ushering in our gathering, but in the beginning, I want to thank God for all our senior pastors that are in the house. When they come here, I will introduce them as well. My name is Ademola Bagola. I'm the area pastor for our area 3. My fellow pastors, assistant area pastor, Pastor Richanda, and all the other ones with their wives, they are here. My wife is also here by the grace of God. So it's going to be a glorious day in the name of Jesus. Please let us rise up and pray. Everlasting Father, we commit this service as we continue into your hands. We pray that you have your way in this place today. As you visited people in the scriptures and great things happened in their life, so do we visit us today and great things will happen in our lives in the name of Jesus. Upon each and every one of us, we plead the precious blood of Jesus. We pray that we will be acceptable in your sight. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Please, the choir, take your position. Let us be quick. Let the choir be quick, please. Dear Lord, you have 5 minutes. That's what I said.
Hallelujah. Amen. Can we just lift up our hands and begin to worship the King of Glory? His word is to be praised. Father, we worship.
great privilege and it's a great honor for our area to be chosen out of many areas. Somebody said that the graduation yesterday, I'm still wondering how it came to our talk. But I know God has a special position for us. And that invitation, we know you are brought here. I've told people that my daddy, wherever he goes, he carry God with him. So we can be rest assured that there is a secure place. Yeah. One more time, we are welcoming Jesus today. Yeah. I want to welcome Pastor Mo from the central office. My colleague pastor is here, as well as director of the Bible College, Pastor Daniel Akazema. He's traveling in Justin Van last week and he said he will be here to support us. May the Lord God continue to bless you, sir.
Yes.
And my zonal pastor is also here, Pastor David Akomalape. I want to go back to the talk to welcome the Assistant General Overseer to Momijio. I call her Satiko. Praise God. I think that the only one who knows how to call the name properly before she has collected me. She says she's not genius, she's genius. Am I correct, ma'am? No, bless you. We welcome you, Pastor Shemontesi, one of our senior pastors as well.
We
Glory be to God. So once again, I want to say big thank you to our Father in the Lord, Daddy Gio and Mommy Gio. You are welcome. God bless you. It's all praise time. I didn't hear you. It's all praise time. I'd like to read from Genesis chapter 8. Genesis chapter 8. The Bible reads in verse 22. While the earth remained, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night shall not cease. This is a rare privilege that we have to prepare our seed. If you need an envelope, like I do, I need an envelope. The ushers will come to you and give you an envelope. And please, you are welcome to give, whether by card or by check. This is an opportunity that God gives us to sow a seed. And if there is any better day that we may have in this area to sow a seed, is today, whilst our daddy and our mommy are here. And because they have come with the Almighty God, I believe your seed will germinate, it will grow, and it will bear much fruit. As you prepare your offering, please take note on the envelope where it says put your card details. Make sure you put all your card details, the expiry date and the valid date. And as you do that, please do not forget to put your signature on your offering. And as you put your signature on the offering, you can sign on the right side of the envelope to indicate what the offering is all about. And please, giving by cash, you can indicate. If you are giving by check, deliberately we are using one type of envelope, you can write the check to RCCE. It's for the whole area. And when you are done, you can pray over your seed. Believe God, act faith. The Bible declares in Hebrews chapter 4 verse 2 that the same gospel was preached unto them, but it did not profit them because they did not mix it with faith. This is your opportunity to mix it with faith. Hallelujah. If you have prepared your offering, you can lift your envelope and we're going to corporately pray. Let's pray. Lift up your envelope and we'll pray together. Heavenly Father, we come in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We obey your way. We come to sow our seed in the house of the living God. And our Father in heaven, look upon our seed. Pour your spirit upon our seed. That it will terminate, it will grow, and it will bear much fruit. Father, may you bless the hands that give out of a willing heart. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And everyone shouted. Let's welcome the Christ.
Yeah.
Ajiboye to take the next second.
Hallelujah. Praise the living Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you for being called back. I'm just shaking. I never knew that I was this much.
Thank you. we are visiting two people here today. Please let me be one of them.
Psalm 102, verse 13.
shall arise.
Amen.
And have mercy upon Zion. For the time to favor her, yea, the set time is come. We want to talk very briefly about the hour of visitation. As a matter of fact, the original purpose for my coming is to pray for you, which I've already done.
God bless you.
And I believe that the answer is already on the way. And then we want to add about 15 minutes or so of the word, us forever, O Lord, and what is said. When the hour of visitation comes for a man or a woman, it always comes unexpectedly. When God decides to visit somebody, it doesn't fall ahead of time. You say, I'm coming. It comes unexpectedly. In 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 11 to 13, 1 Samuel 16, 11 to 13, David was busy singing psalms among sheep in the bush. When he woke up that morning, if anybody came to him and said, before the night falls, you will be a king, he would have laughed. But all of a sudden, somebody came and said, David, he said, yes, you are wanted at home. He said, what for? Well, there's one old man there. Looks a bit different. Might be a prophet or something. And he said that this will come and bring you urgent. David didn't know what was going on. But you know the rest of the story. They arrived. The man of God poured oil on his head and said, God save the king. It came unexpectedly. In 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 8 to 16, 1 Kings 17, 8 to 16, the widow of Zarephath had been going downhill financially, daily, and has reached a stage where she had contemplated suicide with herself. But just as she was gathering two little sticks to prepare the last meal, her hour of visitation came. It was unexpected. In 1 Kings chapter 19, from verse 19 to 21, 1 Kings 19, from verse 19 to 21. Elisha was busy in his father's farm, plowing the ground with the other servants. All of a sudden, a man was passing by and threw his mantle upon him. He turned to see the man and found that it was Elijah the prophet. Something told him, your hour of visitation has come. I have a feeling deep within me that somebody here today is about to get a visitation from God. I believe that there's someone here who is in for a surprise. The hour of visitation always comes unexpectedly. That's the first one. Second thing about the hour of visitation is that it is always personal. It's always for an individual. In Exodus chapter 3, from verse 1 to 12, Exodus 3, 1 to 12, Moses was at the back side of the desert. He was an 80-year-old man. At that time, he had retired, as it were. But then, suddenly, his hour of visitation came. He saw a bush burning. The bush was not burnt. And somebody who started in the morning as a shepherd ended that day becoming the leader of a nation. But the visitation was for him and for him alone. You can cite the scriptures. You'll never find another story of somebody who saw the bush burning and the bush was not complete. It was personal. In Mark chapter 10, from verse 46 to 52, Mark 10, 46 to 52, there was this man called Bartimaeus. He was by the roadside begging. Jesus came to town, and the Bible said a great multitude followed him. Great multitude. But by the end of that day, the only person for whom Jesus came to town became known. Because throughout that visit, the only fellow who got a miracle was Bartimaeus. There was a multitude. A divine visitation is always personal. In John chapter 5, from verse 2 to 9, John 5, from verse 2 to 9, the Bible tells us of a pool called the Pool of Bethesda. He said this pool has a certain healing power that is evident or becomes operative whenever an angel will come down once a year to trouble the water. The first one to get in will be healed. And then the Bible said there was a man who had been there for 38 years. Unexpectedly, not an angel this time, we were always expecting the angel, but this time, the one who made the angels came and located only one man out of the multitude, healed him, and left the place. Because the hour of visitation is always personal. I wish I could say that God has come to Edmonton. For a large crowd of people. But the truth of the matter is that it comes always for one person. Who is that one person? The third thing about our visitation is that whenever it happens to any man, the life of the person can never be the same. It leads to tremendous transformations. In Acts chapter 3, verse 1 to 8, Acts 3, verse 1 to 8, we read about a man who had been lame since birth. And he was always at the gate of the temple. And many people go to the temple every day to worship. Unexpectedly, this man had a divine visitation. And from that day onward, he never had to beg again.
Amen!
Because his ankle bones received strength. And the one who could not walk became someone who could be walking, leaping, and jumping for joy. In 2 Chronicles chapter 1, verse 6 to 15, 2 Chronicles 1, verse 6 to 15, we read about a young king called Solomon. He was a very special son of his father and mother. And so he was practically spoiled. He was so dull, he himself knew he was dull. So when God paid him an unexpected visit, and God asked him what he wanted, he said he wanted wisdom. When that visitation was over, Solomon became the wisest man who had ever lived apart from the Lord Jesus Christ. So when the hour of visitation comes, there will be a change physically, there will be a change mentally. In Genesis chapter 18 from verse 1 to 14, Genesis 18 from verse 1 to 14, Abraham woke up one morning and he was sitting in front of his tent when he had his own hour of divine visitation. That day, the barrenness that had been in the family for almost 100 years ended. So when the hour of visitation comes, it affects you physically. It affects you mentally.
Amen.
It affects you maritally.
Amen.
Acts chapter 2, verse 1 to 4. Acts 2, verse 1 to 4. The Bible says on the day of Pentecost, when the people gathered together in Jehovah, suddenly, remember, our visitation comes suddenly, unexpected. Suddenly, the Holy Spirit came. And everyone became filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues. Whenever the hour of visitation comes, it brings comprehensive transformation, physical, mental, financial,
Amen.
But then, probably the most important thing about the hour of visitation is that it happens only once in a lifetime.
Oh, thank you, Jesus!
Only once. Because Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1 to 8, Ecclesiastes 3, 1 to 8, stated clearly, as far as God is concerned, he has a timetable for everything. For everything, there's a season. For every purpose, there is a time. That's why I rejoice with you. Because somehow, in the timetable of God, like somebody said, one of the pastors said, it is the tongue of somebody. That's why he said, you will arise and have mercy. Before the set time. That's God. The word set time there is like when you set an alarm. The alarm will not ring 1 second too soon. It will not ring 1 second too late. It's always set time.
Amen.
I will tell you just one story and then we will pray. Some of you probably had it before. Because it will illustrate everything about the hour of the situation. And the sermon is brief for a purpose. Because this is someone you must remember for the rest of your life.
Amen.
Forget it. If it is short, you'll be able to see one by one out of the situation comes suddenly. Out of the situation is for individuals. Out of the situation transforms life completely. Out of the situation is once in a lifetime. We are having what we call crossover service, December 39th of a particular year. I was preaching. Suddenly I heard God say that there was someone in the crowd who was finding it difficult to pay his house rent. And God asked me to tell the fellow that by the new year, he will become a landlord.
Amen.
Now, in Lagos, that doesn't make sense. Because every house in Lagos has an owner. But there was only one fellow, one, in the crowd, a messenger, who was having a problem paying his house rent, and who had enough faith to believe that with God all things are possible. It was the only one who said, Amen.
Amen.
I'm sure the others must have looked at him and said that anybody that is a true prophecy, can it be you? But then the new year came after the holidays, and he went to work. He saw the chairman of the company and went to greet the Yoruba, the prostrated. Happy New Year, sir. And the chairman looked at him and said, ah, messenger. He said, sir, have I given you a Christmas present? He said, no, sir. Have I given you a New Year present? He said, no, sir. Ah, he said, well, the first state was selling some houses. I did it for one. I won. I don't need it. Come and take the keys. Because it was days. But then he collected the key and the address and went to the address. He was expecting one small house, one little flat. He got there, he found that it was a mansion.
Amen.
And this is true. He puts the key in, the door opened.
Amen.
He went all over the house, went upstairs, and am I dreaming? The following day, he went to the chairman. This time he didn't just prostrate. He rode to the right, he rode to the left. And the chairman said, messenger, he said, sir, is there any furniture in the house? He said, no, sir. The chairman said, I change my furniture every Christmas. The one I used last year, I don't even know where to put them yet. So he called one of the drivers and said, go and load my furniture and take it to this boy's house. On December 31, he was having a problem paying his house rent. And the first week of January, he is not only in his own house, he was sitting on the chairman's furniture. Why? Because he's out of the situation. It came to him suddenly. It came to him alone. It transformed his life completely. And I believe that there is someone here today that the Almighty God has decided to visit. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, 2 Corinthians 6, verse 2, the Bible says,
This is the accepted time.
Amen.
Today is the day of salvation.
Amen.
That means number one, if someone is here who has not surrendered his or her life to Jesus Christ, this is your day. This is your day because the kind of thing we've been talking about, this kind of hour of visitation, can only be made possible by God, not by anyone. There is no human way of thinking that somebody who entered the new year a tenant, having problem to pay his house rent, and become a landlord sitting on chairman's chair on the furniture. It takes God. The only one who can guarantee that the rest of your life will be completely different, physically, mentally, maritally, spiritually,
Amen.
Is God. That is why if you are here and you have not yet surrendered your life to Jesus, you should do so now. And I will only give you just 2 minutes to come and stand before me so that I can pray for your salvation. I will come from one to surrender your life to Jesus to come now. After that, the rest of us will be praying. So if you want to come, come now, counting 1, 2. This is only for the individuals. If you like, you can say that. But the one who can save your soul, who can transform your life, is here today, is calling you. 3. Call on you, answer them by fire.
Amen.
And
let them celebrate it here.
Amen.
Thank you, Father. Now, my Father and my God, in a moment, your children here will be crying out to you. You have the power to save one, and you have the power to save all.
Amen.
You have the power to heal one.
Amen.
You have the power to heal all.
Amen.
You have the power to bless one.
Amen.
You also have the power to bless all.
Amen.
When they cry unto you today, Lord God Almighty, grant their request. Whatever they ask you for, my Father and my God, do for them today.
Amen.
And for the rest of their lives,
amen,
let them remember today for good.
Amen.
Thank you, Almighty God.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed.
Amen.
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 Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And those of you who have come forward, I want to rejoice with you. Because for now, by the grace of God, I'll be praying for you. So I will be needing your names, your address,
amen,
and your prayer requests.
Amen.
And I'm sure very soon you'll begin to feel the impact of
it. Amen!
But I want you to remain where you are for now, because I want you to join the rest of us as we pray.
Oh, thank you, Baba. Thank
and all of us who believe that God will answer us today, please stand on your feet. And those who pray for you can start to.
I say, Father,
Father,
I know you are here because of me.
I know you are here because of me.
So bless me today.
So bless me today. Father, I know you are here because of me. You are here because of me and my family and my household. Surprise me today. Surprise me today. Surprise me today. You are here. This is my power of visitation. Father, I will never let you go unless you bless me, unless you visit me. Surprise me today, Father. Surprise me. Surprise my husband. Surprise my children. My children, children. My children's husband. My children, wife for me. Father, don't want to surprise you. Surprise my husband. Surprise my family. Surprise me.
Father, surprise me today. Let me be my day of visitation. For greater things in my life. Let this be a turning point in every area of my life. In my health, in my finances. Father, surprise me today. Let this be my day of visitation. Let this be my day of visitation. Let this be the day of a new dawn in my life. Lord, surprise me today. As you visited Bartimaeus and you changed his life. As you visited Moses and a new beginning came at the age of 18. As you visited the man, even by the beautiful gate, and the man began to walk. Father, surprise me today. Let it be a day of uncommon visitation. A day of permanent turnaround. In the mighty name of Jesus. Father, surprise me today. Surprise me today. Visit me in a new way. Father, surprise me today. New grace, new anointing, new power. Father, surprise me today. Surprise me today. Abraham, and you remove barrenness. Father, surprise me today. As you visited Solomon, and you became the wisest man. Father, surprise me today. There is an appointed time. Father, let this be my appointed time. As Pentecost came,
suddenly and brought about transformation. Let it be our transformation time, our Pentecost time, in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. We give you praise. Let's thank him, because it is by faith. If you believe it, then I can assure you the Lord God of heaven is faithful. If you believe it, can you shout a very powerful hallelujah? Can you shout one more hallelujah? Can you shout one more hallelujah? Listen to me, beloved. When divine visitation has happened, the next thing that follows is glory. The opposite of glory is shame. And shame is not our portion. If you believe that you have just entered into your season of glory, can you shout glory?
Glory!
I can hear you. Can you shout glory?
Glory!
One more time. Can you shout glory?
Glory!
And if God has visited us, then we must be able to say thank you to him. So the first thing I want you to say is, we are going to shout thank you Jesus three times. Can we go ahead and say thank you Jesus?
Thank you, Jesus.
I can't hear you. Can you say thank you Jesus?
Thank you, Jesus.
One more time, can I hear you? Thank you Jesus.
Thank you,
Jesus. I want us to couple our faith with action, and I want us to give a good Thanksgiving offering to God. It's a seed of faith that I know that this is done. I know that this that I have received today is permanent. So the ushers will quickly give us envelopes and we'll take the Thanksgiving offering very quickly.
Come, let's pray.
Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it, still you yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, I think it is half our presence. I think it is half our honor and our adoration. Because the Lord has celebrated for another 1 minute. Oh, say, Lord, I thank you. Lord, I honor you, Lord, I celebrate. Oh, thank you for focusing your attention on me. Thank you for focusing your attention on me. You can say something glorious to me. You can say something awesome, something wonderful. He has visited me. And he has visited me. He has done something with my soul. Let him know that you appreciate him. Let him know that you appreciate him. Let him know that you appreciate him. Father, we thank you. Lord, we honor your name for us. We celebrate your father. We celebrate your father. We celebrate your father. We celebrate your father. Thank you for you. We thank you for what you have done for us. We honor you, Lord. For in Jesus' name alone, we have been blessed. For in Jesus' name alone, we have been blessed.
Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down.